Welcome, thank you. My name is Marko. We're going to talk about TinkerPop and Gremlin and graphs, but we're not actually probably going to talk about Gremlin, TinkerPop, or graphs in any way. I'm going to try and make an argument for a new style of data query language in which you can, I think this is going to be the way in which future query languages are going to be done. No more fat strings, no more creating an SQL query in a string and submitting it to a server and getting a result set back. It's all about coding in your native programming language. So you code against data, your database, and you code against your analytics system, all in your native programming language. I'm going to show you how that works. The example of how that is going to work is through Gremlin. So I'm going to give a rough, just try and follow along. A bunch of stuff's going to come at you. This first half of this talk, free association. Don't try and think too hard. You might get lost. Just follow along. We have a function. What does a function do? It maps some domain to some range. For example, if you have the function f, it's going to map object of type x to an object of type x. For example, if we want to instantiate that function or run that function, execute that function, let's take x1, it's an object in x, we apply it, and let's get it, it says it gives us x2. X2 is also an object in x. Now let's go ahead and call this function a step, and a step will do that operation. Let's call f of x a 90 degree rotation. And so we don't really care how it does the 90 degree rotation, we just know that's a black box. This particular step will rotate something by 90 degrees. What will it rotate by 90 degrees? Let's call that thing a traversal. A traversal wraps a value of type V. So let's have a class traversal that wraps some type of value by type V. So if we have a traversal that's an integer, it's going to yield a traversal of an integer. And so if we give it a traversal with rotation 0, once we rotate it 90 degrees, we'll be at a traversal with a rotation of 90. Let's give a visualization of that. If we have a little gremlin, and he's standing like that, and we rotate him 90 degrees, he's going to be looking like this. And so then what is this kind of function we're doing? We're taking a traversal that has a number, an integer, and we're mapping to a traversal that has a number of integer. So both these two gremlins are in these sets of T of N. Now let's take a stream of traversers. If we have a stream of traversers and we're going to rotate them all by 90 degrees, what's that going to look like? A bunch of little traversers all sideways like this. So an input stream running through that function, through that step, is going to yield a bunch of output traversers. Now let's add a construct to this concept of a traversal. A traversal has a value, as we said before, that's that value v. We're also going to add a bulk. What is a bulk? It's a long counter. It says how many values does this particular traversal represent? Why do we do this? Well, instead of executing that function four times, why don't we just say that we have four 0-degree traversers, and when we run the function, we have four 90-degree rotated traversers. And in essence, we've reduced the amount of computation we have to do by four steps down to one step. So let's take a variegated stream. We have a variegated stream of input traversers. These are all at different rotations, and we're going to do a 90-degree transformation. It looks like this. However, because of bulking, we have, if we bulk on the input stream, we have one, and now we have two. Before, let's go back, we had two guys of the same sort. And so now we have two guys of the same sort. Once they come on the other side, you have one, two, and one. Again, use your streams, find identities in your streams, and try and compress them using this concept of bulking so you do not have to run the execution of that function over and over again. However, let's say this. If ordering of the stream does not matter, for example, none of two things in the same row matter, but if ordering does not matter, let's go ahead and reorder the stream before we execute the function such that we've got the function reduction. So the total bulk is four, total count is four. But on the other side, if we did a resort, we have a total four and a total count of three. What is a traversal? We talked about a step. A step is kind of a traversal with one step in it. But now you can start to compose step to create a longer list of traversals. For example, we have this, this gremlin here standing up. We rotate 90 degrees. We rotate him 90. We do it again. We rotate him 180. We do it again, 270. We do it one more time. He's done 360. So we've just done one kind of step. However, you can have different types of steps, different types of functions with different types of domains and ranges. So let's go ahead and take this function f. Let's redefine it such that it maps from some x to some y. And let's say we have some h function that maps from some y to some z. If you're doing this like computer programming notation, also known as Courier font, you got y equals f of x and z equals h of y, where that y maps down to that guy. So you kind of like, you know, look at this like that. We don't need to type the variables. Let's just drop into math notation, aka LaTeX. So you can go from Courier font to LaTeX, not much different. Let's go ahead and flip those variables about. F of x gives us y, h of y gives us z. Let's go ahead and offset those guys. Let's go ahead and pop them down like this. This is another way to write functions. You can say x, I'm going to apply x to f and then f to h, and use function composition in this notation like this. This is readable, that is not readable is the argument I'm going to make right here. So in essence, instead of nesting functions in like kind of a lispy style, let's go ahead and just do function catenation in a fluent method chaining style. And so we can say z equals like this. Let's go back to our computer notation. We're going to have an x. We call it the head, the start of the stream. We're going to apply an f, then we're going to apply an h. Next out of that stream is our z. So we went from kind of this math notation back to computer programming notation, where we're not nesting our variables or not nesting our functions. We're chaining our functions. So we had two types of functions. We had a 90-degree rotation. Now we have another one, which is 225. If you start to compose things, you get query expressivity. Now I can get this kind of offset, weird kind of looking gremlin because I've done a 315-degree rotation. This would look like this. You can take a little gremlin, apply 90, apply 20, next amount, give me a little guy half offset. How would I do some kind of repeating? So I've showed you how to do function chaining. Let's talk about function nesting. Function nesting is I want to provide a function into a function as an argument. This is kind of like closures or lambdas in Gremlin or in these kind of style of query language embedding. You're taking a traversal and providing that traversal as an argument to a traversal or to a particular step. So I want to repeat 90 degrees two times. In essence, I want to do a 180-degree rotation. What is this times two? We call these step modulators. So repeat is a step, and times two is just a modulator to that step. It's a way of just giving it some more argumentation. Of course, I could have done a comma two after that 90. It starts to look ugly. There's a lot of ways why you would want to have, a lot of reasons why you want to have like these modulators. For example, I have someone here, select A and B by their name, group count by their out degree, add an edge from A to B, order by the age decker. Again, I don't need to have this by, I can put this into there, but there's reason of just cleanliness and what the when you read it out, it means something. You just don't have arbitrary arguments and what these arguments mean. Now I'm going to introduce the concept of a traversal strategy. A traversal strategy is able to rewrite algebraically one traversal into another traversal. So if something is equivalent semantically, I can rewrite it. Instead of doing repeat 92 times, I say, hell, well, let me just go unroll that loop and just do 90 twice. Traversal strategies is a concept, again, to algebraically rewrite something to a more simple form, something that's going to be more efficient to execute. How do we do, we can do something like this. Repeat this process until I get a traversal at 0 degrees. This pops us out like this. That first guy had to do four loops. So the first guy on the right is this guy all the way here on the right over as well, because the first time he did a 90, and so he has to keep going four times to become 0 degrees. The second guy only had to do it twice. The third guy only had to do it once. So this is do while semantics. Repeat until. If you want to do while do, well, just flip your until. You get it until 0 degrees, repeat. What's the difference here is I didn't have to do any loops on that first guy, because I checked the until on the 0 degrees, 0 degrees matches, I don't need to throw him through repeat, he pops out the other side unrotated. Even if the input stream cannot be bulked, the output traversers may be able to be. So I have a variegated stream, but however, once they get all repeated and all at 0 degrees, now I can bulk them. Bulking is very important. Always try and reduce the amount of computation you're trying to do. Don't stress your processor. So you have a bunch of the general category of the type of steps that you'll always be doing in any kind of programming and data flow or querying. You're going to do map functions, you're going to do flat maps, filters, and side effects. A map is a one-to-one mapping. Take something and transform it in some way. A flat map is a one-to-many. Take something and yield me many. A filter is take this thing, either let it pass or kill it. And a side effect is let it pass, however, yield some kind of background data structure on the side. In Gremlin, we have lots of different steps, and you get maybe 10 of them you ever use, but there's probably a good 30 of them that exist, and this is just a subset of them. And so they all fit in this kind of map, flat map, filter, side effect categories, and that's how they're categorized. But let's go ahead and look at a few right here. Let's go ahead and pull these out, and let's type these things. All about the typing. Remember, functions map from one thing to another thing. Let's look at out-nose. Out-nose takes a traverser at a vertex and yields a stream of traversers at a vertex. So I am Marko, and I'm a traverser at the Marko vertex. I might know many people, Marko might know many people, so I yield many traversers at the people that Marko knows. That's a flat map, one to many. I can do a one-to-one. Let's look at this has name gremlin. I'm at a vertex or an edge. Does it have a property named gremlin? It does. Let him pass, if not, kill him. Label, for example, what's the label of this vertex or edge? From that vertex or edge, map me to a traverser that is the string representation of that particular label. Let's look at a query. G.v has name, gremlin, out, nose, values, age, group count. I want to get the distribution of ages of the people that gremlin knows. So we have these pretty particular steps right here. Let's go ahead and align them like this. So we see we start from the graph, and we go to a stream of vertices, and then we go from those vertices to only those that know Gremlin, and we're still at vertices, those vertices to the people he knows, and then from those vertices to the age, which is some numeric number, positive numeric number, some group count, we don't know what that is yet, to some map that's a count. However, when we start to order these, we see that this is actually what the representation of the language is, such that we go from graph to vertex, from vertex to vertex, from vertex to vertex, from vertex to number, to a map of numbers counted. So what is the distribution of ages to the people that Gremlin knows? What are we doing here? One graph to many vertices, G dot V, says, give me this graph and just line out all the vertices, so stream out all the vertices. That's a flat map. Which one of these, of all the vertices, check every one. Is your name Gremlin? Is your name Gremlin? Is your name Gremlin? Is your name Gremlin? Either let that vertex go through or don't let it go through. For that one, for all the vertices named Gremlin, let's assume there's only one vertex named Gremlin, give me who his friends are. So from one that guy, it's another flat map and starts spreading out all the people that Gremlin knows. From values ages, for every vertex, give me their age, and then a group count, which is a map, but it's also a reduction map. We call it a barrier, in the sense it just starts sucking in all the different ages and then generates one reduction, which is the map representation. So this is the distribution of the ages of the people that know Gremlin. Okay, now you're fast and furious. Now let's break this up a little bit and just kind of explain what Gremlin is in terms of a language and what Gremlin is in terms of a virtual machine. Gremlin is all about being language agnostic as well as machine agnostic. If you have a programming language, Perl, Java, Groovy, Ruby, JavaScript, PHP, Clojure, Scala, something else. All those languages support the notion of function composition and function nesting. If you have a programming language that supports those two things, you can represent the Gremlin style of traversal, the Gremlin style of data querying. And this is the argument I want to make from the beginning, that if you're going to develop a query language, develop it in such a way that it can do function composition and function nesting, because then your language, your query language, can be embedded in any programming language. And so what is function composition? In typical like Java, those kind of things, it's this fluent chaining, dot notation, dot, 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 dot. What is function nesting, method arguments? Well, I can do a method chain into a particular argument, or I can just do like, you know, one, two, a value, a constant. So this is all that Gremlin is. It's either fluent chaining or nesting of traversals and constants into a traversal. Okay, so the Gremlin traversal machine. So that's the language. All you have to do is just do function chaining and function nesting. That's all there is to it. The machine has four concepts. Has the traverser. We talked about that. Traversers just encapsulate some value, and then you're going to apply a particular step to that traverser, which is going to map that thing in some way. It's going to change its value in some way. Steps get composed together to create a traversal. So you have traversal, which is a composition of steps. And then you have traversal strategies, which know how to take a traverser and optimize it in some way. That's your compiler optimization. That's all there is to Gremlin. So let's look at Gremlin Java. What is the data flow? If someone types in a particular query, here's a query up at the top, it gets translated into something called bytecode. We haven't discussed bytecode. The rest of the talk is all about this notion of bytecode. It's a nested list representation of your traversal. Language agnostic, has nothing to do with Java. It's just a bunch of nested lists. That bytecode gets sent to the traversal machine, which gets compiled into these steps, which then gets optimized by traversal strategies. For example, that repeat step, if we're doing it twice, why not just unroll the loop into two vertex steps, and then you execute the traversal. Gremlin Python, what's the difference? Gremlin Python looks just like that, looks identical to Gremlin Java. And it generates the same bytecode. And from that bytecode, then it gets submitted to the traversal machine, and that gets executed. So here's this delineation. You have your language, and you have your machine. It's very easy to go ahead and create a language that generates Gremlin bytecode. There's Gremlin Python, there's Gremlin Groovy, there's Gremlin Java, there's Gremlin Scala, Gremlin Ruby's coming out, Gremlin JavaScript's coming out, and Gremlin Clojure exists. So all those guys generate bytecode, which ultimately gets implemented, executed on some machine. The only graph traversal machine that we have right now is the TinkerPop one. It's based in Java. Someone could build one in Python. Someone can build one in anything. Then you can have any language talk to any virtual machine. And for example, why is it built on Java? Well, most graph databases right now, DSEGraph, Neo4j, OrientDB, all those guys, they're Java-based implementations. ArongoDB has a C++ implementation of graph database. They're like, why is this all Java? Well, hell, go ahead and build a C++ machine, and then all of our languages can talk to your machine as well. Let's look at CPython. Here's Gremlin Python. I drop into CPython. This has nothing, this is not Jython. This is Python, just drop into the shell in your Python shell. You've already pip installed Gremlin Python. You import graph, you import remote connection. I create a graph object from the graph object, create a traversal, give it a connection to where the host of where the virtual machine is. So it's a WebSocket connection to the virtual machine. And what can I do? I just execute a traversal. And what's that doing? It's sending the bytecode to the Apache TinkerPop traversal machine, getting a result set back. Looks just like it's you. If your function, if your language supports function composition and function nesting, you can embed Gremlin in that language. There's no fat string here. You don't need to send fat strings everywhere. The whole notion of SQL having a different language in your programming language is insane. Don't do that. I mean, I don't know why people do that. Just your programming language. People are good at Python. Let them code in Python. There's nothing to learn. You can have something even nastier. This is a deeply nested match statement, which is going to do some kind of predicate matching, well, similar to Sparkle, things like that. You can do this as well in Python. Why do I have this little as, underscores? As is a reserved word, in is a reserved word. So we put underscores. There's certain languages have reserved words, and in order to be able to represent the query, we use an underscore. So what does this mean? This means that there is a translator. It's called Gremlin Python that converts Sparkle to bytecode. Someone, Ted Wilms right here, wrote SQL to bytecode. There's Gremlin, all the different Gremlin variants, Gremlin Python, Gremlin Java, Gremlin Groovy, Gremlin other ones. They all convert to bytecode. They can execute on the Gremlin traversal machine. Something called Cypher exists. Neo4j developed Cypher. Someone writes a bytecode translator. Well, guess what? You can run Neo4j Cypher over any graph database that implements the TinkerPop virtual machine. Go bytecode. Don't directly represent your code against your database. Okay, if anyone knows what Sparkle is, Sparkle is an RDF query language. It's like a pattern matching language. Sparkle Gremlin is basically a translator that converts the Sparkle language into a bytecode representation. So there is your Sparkle query, select distinct C, where A is a person, A created B, B has some name C, and A, which is the vertex of the person, his age is greater than 30. Ultimately, this gets translated to this representation in Gremlin bytecode, which is sent to the wire. So you can, in essence, use Sparkle against your graph database. Gremlin is more than just this notion of the Gremlin chaining. There's distinct query languages, and there's Gremlin variants. We've seen the Gremlin variants. This is a distinct query language. It looks nothing like Gremlin. You can still translate it, though. Just write a compiler. So what is also cool about Gremlin? That traversal, Gremlin traversal machine is a really cool machine because not only does it execute against OLTP databases, a traversal can also execute against an OLAP database. So this means that you can do both your OLTP queries as well as your analytic queries with the same query language. I don't do SQL, and then I go into Spark and do data flows in Spark. It's just Gremlin. OLTP, OLAP, it doesn't matter. It knows how to convert between the two because it compiles to Spark's native stuff. It compiles to Giraffe's native stuff, so forth and so on. Traversal strategies. We talked about traversal strategies. Unroll loop. If you're going to do a repeat twice, why have all the semantics of repeat? Just do the same construct twice. What's going to happen is OLTP providers and graph processor providers are going to have registered strategies in order to take unique advantage of particular features that that database or processor provides. For example, DataStax Enterprise Graph. This is DSEGraph. If we did this g.v has name gremlin, let's just look at that component. We're not looking at the rest of the query. If before you do an optimization, it's going to take that graph and it's just going to iterate all the vertices out. If you have a billion vertices, it's just going to scroll all those vertices out and check each one. Are you gremlin? 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 That's inefficient. What do you typically do in a database? Use an index. So they have something called a graph step strategy that takes that gv has, in fact, takes any v has star sequence and converts it to an index lookup. This is where strategies can play, come into play. TinkerPop has no notion of indices, but vendors might have a notion of an index, so it'll look for patterns in the bytecode and convert it accordingly such that it can use its own local indices. Spark, g.v.count. There's a count how many vertices in the graph. Well, how would this look? In essence, I'm just going to big old linear scan of all the vertices, and I'm going to count all the vertices, use an aggregator in Spark, and then it's going to write that out to a file, blah, 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 or an output RDD, bunch of junk. What's more efficient to do? We have something called a Spark interceptor strategy. It says, what, you just want to do a count? Well, I just call a direct count on the RDD. So you can do these kind of optimizations. Spark already has a count operator. There's no point to go through all the semantics of the Gremlin virtual machine. Why not just bypass all that, just do a count, and then write the count to the right output? In essence, you can use the native constructs if you need to do things that are just a little bit more optimal. So you're not just always constrained to what the virtual machine is going to do for you. So what are we looking at? In computing, you have a physical machine. This is like your Intel box. And then you have memory and disk, and that's where your data is. And in memory, you typically have your program. There's a bunch of instructions, like assembly instructions, machine instructions. They're going to operate on that particular piece of memory, mutating data, making a computation happen. Java came around and said, OK, what we're going to do is we're going to abstract away the physical machine. We don't care about the physical machine. You're going to write programs in something called Java bytecode. And that's going to, the bytecode, the virtual machine, is going to go ahead and manipulate data. Instead of calling it memory, they call it the heap. And they also have the disk. TinkerPop comes along and abstracts away the Java virtual machine. So now it can run against the Java virtual machine. It can run against the C machine. It can run against the C machine, the C Python machine, whatever other machines exist out there. And what it cares about are traversals, steps. That's its memory. And its data is the graph itself. That's the representation that we're using. So again, this is just following that line of evolution where we're saying, let's keep abstracting away so we're just not pigeonholed into Java. We're not pigeonholed into Python. We're not pigeonholed into sending fat strings across a wire. So who are the stakeholders? These are three types of people that come into play when they're coming to TinkerPop. You have application developers. These are just people who want to use a graph, building a graph application. They really don't care about graphs so much. They're just saying, like, I got to build an app. I got to do some job. I got to do it now. You got the language providers. These are people who create Gremlin language variants, like the C Python guys, or they create distinct query language, for example, Sparkle. It's not like a Gremlin looking style, but they can take advantage of the Gremlin machine. And then the third type of stakeholder are the system providers. Who are the guys who built the graph databases? Who are the guys who built the OLAP processors? These are your Hadoops, your DSEGraphs. These are your Neo4j's. These are your OrientDBs, your Sparks, your Flume, your Flukes, and all those other Apache whatevers. So let's go ahead and look at application developers. What are the benefits they get? They get one query language for all OLTP OLAP systems. That developer does not have to learn SQL, learn Java, learn Spark DSL. All they need to know is Java, and once they know Java, for example, if they're programming in Java, then they can just execute Gremlin over OLTP OLAP. There's not a whole bunch of languages going on. Your query language and your programming language are the exact same thing. No vendor lock-in. What's really cool about TinkerPop is you can plug and play your backend. The vendors optimize through strategies to make sure it executes as efficiently as possible against their particular database, so you don't get this notion of, oh, it's way inefficient because all these layers. No, vendors know how to use indices correctly, vertex-centric indices, global indices, all these different kinds of tips and tricks that vendors will do to bypass and make things efficient for their particular quote-unquote operating system, quote-unquote database. And so these are all, there's a lot more of them, but this, think of Apache TinkerPop as like the JDBC for graphs. So the application developer isn't constrained. They don't just write their stuff to one database system and go, oh, I'm stuck. We're not going to rewrite everything. You can plug and play your backend. Much like if you know SQL, you can use Postgres, you can use Oracle, you can use MySQL. With Gremlin, once you know Gremlin, you can use all these guys. Plug and play. Here is the notion of embedded language. So in SQL, if I want to get the get the names of the oldest people in my graph, or my order by age, get the names of the oldest people in my graph. What you would do in Java with SQL is you'd create an execute query and make a string, you'd submit that and you iterate it. Again, in Gremlin Java, this is your native programming language. That is just Java. It looks like Gremlin, but it's Java. And what's cool about that, in your IDE, you push dot, you see that there's a V, you push dot, you know you have has, you push dot, you know you can do order. You have syntax highlighting, you get compile time running. You can't do compile time stuff with your strings in SQL. No fat strings, you code in your native programming language. Okay, let's go to language providers. These are guys who create things that are going to compile to bytecode. It's really easy to generate bytecode. Look at how Gremlin Python is created. I use reflection in order to generate the source code for Python. So I get all the methods from graph traversal class, and what do? I just, for every method, I do that. There's a lot more, and there's definitely more to it than this. But in essence, I can just, from analyzing the source code or the class of Gremlin Java, I can generate the Gremlin Python classes as well. It's very easy to generate bytecode. Again, now language providers, they don't have to worry about where their stuff's gonna execute. If I'm an RDF database in Sparkle, I'm like, oh, this everything's RDF, or oh, I'm writing SQL, it has to go against a relational database, or I'm writing OpenCypher, that has to go against Neo4j. No, it doesn't matter. You can write, as long as you can compile to bytecode, you can run over anything. They do not have to tie their language to a particular vendor. They can focus on the design of their language, not on the evaluation. Don't worry about OLAP OLTP. As long as you can convert your stuff to bytecode, it can execute as a real-time query, you know, your millisecond OLTP queries, or it can execute against a graph processor, for example, Spark or whatever. You do not have to worry about execution. Just design, make your language beautiful, make your compiler compile it, we'll take care of the rest. Just pass it off to virtual machine, it'll optimize it, and it'll execute it. Okay. Last stakeholders are the graph system providers. These are guys who create the databases, and these are guys who create the analytic systems. What's their role in this? For Apache TinkerPop, it's pretty easy to implement the core interfaces. They have to implement a graph interface. Again, this is for Java. This is the Apache TinkerPop's virtual machine is a Java implementation. Other people can go implement a C1. All we have is a Java one right now. So if you're a Java database, implement the graph interface, the vertex interface, the edge property, transaction, traversal strategy. There's a couple core concepts you just need to implement. I mean, it's nasty. I mean, you're doing a good week exercise, but you can knock it out. You automatically support all provided languages. So you're not saying, well, I don't want to implement TinkerPop because then, you know, it's Gremlin, and I don't know if my users like Gremlin. If they like Sparkle, it's going to work over. If your users want to use Sparkle, it'll work over it. If they want to use SQL, it'll work over it. Again, they automatically inherit all those languages by just implementing the virtual machine constructs. And this is really cool. DataStax Enterprise Graph is an OLTP database. However, Apache TinkerPop distributes with something called Spark Graph Computer. What does DSEGraph say? Hey, all I gotta do is make an input RDD, and now they can suck the whole graph out of DSEGraph and do Spark Analytics on it. We did all the hard work for them. If you have a graph database, let us do the hard work for you. You can run Spark, you can run Graph, anything you want against your any OLAP processor against your graph database by just knowing by creating an input format or input RDD, whatever, for Hadoop, it's input formats. For Spark, it's RDDs. And then from there, TinkerPop will take care of the rest. And again, the execution engine will take care of the rest. It knows whether to do an OLAP job or a real-time OLTP job. So I guess this, if you're going to take a picture of slides, might be a good picture. Applications, so these are the guys, and these are kind of the benefits of each. And I can give you 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Thank you very much, ApacheTinkerPop.com, or Apache.org, and DataStax DSE product is kind of my focus. Thank you.
You got 5 minutes for questions.
5 minutes for questions, yeah. Your schema, for your schema, you notice his name. Because of the last one, it'll automatically type. If you're gonna do something right here, like a concatenation, you'd have to type it right here by putting string in there. Is that what you're asking? That's you knowing it. I mean, you knowing it as a developer that your schema is, you have a string. Oh, yeah, in that sense, yeah. I mean, yeah. We could do something like that. I see what you're saying. We could do something like, for example, before the thing executes, it can say, like, are you trying to return a string? Because it knows it's an iterator string. And if you are, it can check against your schema and then throw an exception. But yeah, right now it's just, yeah, your properties, you have to know that a name, you know. Anybody else? Question? Cool. Well, thank you very much. Really appreciate it. Oh, I'm sorry, dude. What'd you got? So Katrina Yim, she's been working, I've been working with her since like 2009, and She wrote her master's thesis at Berkeley and was teaching kids computer programming. That was her master's thesis, and it was a cartoon, like a manga kind of thing. And she loves to draw, and I asked her to do a logo. She did the Gremlin logo, and it's just from then on, for the last, I don't know, like 9 years, I guess now, she's been always just dropping me graphics whenever I ask her stuff. So she's really good. She gives a lot of character to things. Cool. Appreciate it.